morning, everybody, and welcome. A bit of gospel grace right there. Good to be here. Good morning, everybody on the live stream. Good morning, everybody in the room. It is good, as I keep saying, to be preaching to human beings, even if it is, as Anders said, only eyes and nose. But I tell you what, it is good. And thank you, everybody, for participating. We're trying different things. As I was saying to someone before, you can get lots of good content at home. You can get lots of good, you know, podcasts and that kind of stuff. But it's difficult to get this community at home, isn't it? And so we're trying. We can't sing, and so we're trying different ways of how to interact, how to hear people's voices, different people's voices. So thank you, Jim, and thank you, Janice, and Beck, and whoever else got up here. Is that it? Bridget, yes, so good to see you. Oh, I knew I was going to forget someone if I started listening off. Anyway, it was really good to have you all participate in that. Well, good morning, good morning. I wonder if you heard of something. Is this echoing a bit? It's echoing in my head a little bit here. If we could take some of that up. Thanks, Paul. I wonder if you caught a significant day in Australian history this week. I'm not talking about the end of the World War II, the victory in the Pacific. I am talking about the Australian Ninja Warrior Grand Final for 2020. Did you catch it? Oh, what an event. You got some nods. Anyone into Ninja Warrior, give us some nods or some face marks. Okay, man, I love this series. If you don't know anything about it, let me tell you a little bit about Ninja Warrior. It's based around athletes in seriously good condition, top condition, getting through a series of courses, progressively harder as the series goes on. They're incredibly difficult obstacles that just stretch their physical ability as athletes. Now, once they get to the end, once they're furthest, fastest, once they get into to the end, the final course, they get to tackle this. You know what it's called? Mount Midoriyama. There is no more Aussie thing to say than Mount Midoriyama. It just, as they, every time they say it, I laugh. It's so Aussie. It's a monstrosity. This is a 20-meter rope climb they've got to do in 30 seconds. I can't even begin to imagine how difficult that would be. This is what they do. They do all this with a chance to win $400,000 and to be crowned the Australian Ninja Warrior Champion. It's an awesome show. It's one of those shows you can kind of watch as a young family. We watch it together. And in no time, our home is turned into a Ninja Warrior course. I mean, with the kids have got pillows on the floor, they're jumping from the dining room table to the dining room chairs to pillows, swinging off the ceiling, whatever it is. They love it. And you just, when you're watching it, you can't help but cheer the athletes on. What the pain they're going through to get through these courses. And these are some athletes. Like, you've never seen people in better shape than on this show. And they interview the competitors. It's kind of cool throughout the series. And you get to know a little bit about them, a little bit of background. And they, you know, they say, you know, so what have you been doing to the lead up to Ninja Warrior? That, you know, you competed last year. What's the year been like? How do you think they answer? What have they been doing? Training. They have been doing nothing but training. There's one competitor built a replica of that in his backyard. So he climbed it twice a day. It's no joke. These people are committed to getting through this course, to trying themselves, to the chance to be the best. It's quite incredible. Here is the winner of Ninja Warrior, Ben Paulson. I mean, he looks like Thor, doesn't he, with that blonde hair? And it's like looking in a mirror, really, isn't it? No. I mean, just an incredible athlete. The pain on their faces, they're getting through this, and the joy of standing up there as the Ninja Warrior champion. Now, why are we talking about this morning? It's just my favorite show, and I wanted to talk about it with you. No, I'm kidding. We are in our series called Knowing Who You Are. We're looking at eight images from the New Testament that shed light on what it means to be a Christian. Our identity is a huge thing. What's it like to be a Christian? Well, it's a little bit like being a pilgrim. We are wanderers through this land. We looked at that a few weeks ago. It's a bit like being a citizen of a foreign land. It's a bit like being a farmer. John preached a great message on patience. As a farmer is patient, active and hopeful patience, we are that way as Christians too. And this week we're looking at athlete. Being a Christian, it's a bit like being an athlete. Actually, as you heard read for us so well by Rob, Paul talks about a runner, athlete, or even a boxer. being a Christian is a little bit like being a boxer. In what way? It might be weird to think, it's strange, the Bible using this image as an athlete or a boxer to describe aspects of the Christian life. How are we supposed to understand this metaphor? What about the runner? What about the athlete? What about the ninja warrior? Are we supposed to learn? Well, let's dive into our reading today and find out together. Can we do it together? Are you with me? Yep, okay, let's do it together. Let's read this. It's a short reading. I'm going to read it again for us so it's fresh in our minds. There's a lot in here. I could say a lot this morning. I could preach a whole series on this passage. I'm not going to do it. We're just going to look at two things that's going to help us shape our Christian identity. So here we go. Let's read. Do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I don't run like someone running aimlessly. I don't fight like a boxer beating the air, no. I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I've preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. First thing I want to look at this morning is this. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. Strict training. That's what I'll look at first this morning. Now, who's Paul writing to? In this letter, he's writing to the Corinthians. They're Greeks. They're like Aussies. They know a thing or two about sport. They love sport. The Olympic Games came from Athens, Greece, right? They're big into sport. Paul's probably referring to the Isthmian Games, which is even closer by. So when he's speaking about boxer, athlete, runner, these are images his original audience are familiar with, much like Aussies. We are familiar with what it means to be an athlete. We adore them. We watch them on our screens so much, don't we? Now, just like the ninja warriors of today, just like the Olympic athletes of today, who go into disciplined, strict training, so God's people are to be disciplined when it comes to our spiritual lives. Discipline is where it's at if you want to be good at anything. I don't think I'm telling anybody here or at home anything they don't know when I say that. You want to be good at anything? Discipline, strict training is where it's at. You want to play guitar like Derek or piano like Leslie? What are you going to do? Practice. You got to be, I mean, that was me growing up, you know, eating pizza and learning to play the guitar. That was my teenage years, right? You got to put in the hours. My wife's an amazing artist, but even now she's going back and learning more about the foundation of art. If you want to be a great artist, you've got a natural gift maybe, but you got to hone that. You got to learn the color palette, and you got to learn design and art. You got to learn those foundations if you want to get better as an artist. If you want to learn a language, oh man, be prepared to memorize a lot of vocab. We've got some mates here who've been to college before. You know what I'm talking about, learning, yeah, Koine Greek. You just got to, and people who English is a second language, you just got to memorize so much vocab. And let's not go and get into the grammar, hey, all of those things that just don't do what they're supposed to. You got to remember it all. You want to be good at golf? Be prepared to spend a lot of time at the golf range, hitting thousands of balls. Now, I hear some husbands think, so do I have permission then to do that, Dave? Are you telling me? Well, you can work that out at home. But there's no way around it. There's no way around it. No one rolls out of bed and thinks, I'm going to run a marathon today with no preparation and get through without collapsing due to exhaustion. Now, what's true in these other areas of our life is same for our Christian life. Might come as a bit of a shock, might be a weird thing to say, but growth in the Christian life is not automatic. Growth in the Christian life does not happen automatically and without our participation. Now, let me say this. We are saved by the grace of God, the unmerited mercy and grace of God. And it is that same grace that changes us, transforms us into the image of Christ. We partner with His grace in how we change. Listen to this. The gospel is not opposed to effort. It is opposed to earning. Let me say that again. If you leave with nothing else, leave with this. The gospel is not opposed to effort. It is opposed to earning. We partner with the grace of God as we are transformed and made more like Christ. Now, to grow in godliness means saying yes to some things and no to others, right? We don't just roll out of bed one day and become godly. Christian life's about doing the little things regularly and well. It's about being disciplined enough to train oneself. Look at what Paul says in 1 Timothy. Rather, train yourself to be godly. The physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. We can train ourselves in godliness. But what does that look like? What does it even mean? What does discipline in the Christian life look like? Well, let's think about the athlete. Well, what does being disciplined mean for them? And the very definition of discipline, a part of that is sacrifice, isn't it? What does the athlete do? They sacrifice a great deal in their training to achieve their goal. Think about the swimmer sacrificing sleep to be at that pool to do laps at 5 a.m. I pity the parent of any swimmer who does that. You've got to be out there early. Or the boxer who endures pain to learn what it means to shield yourself against the blows of your opponent's pain. Every athlete knows what it's like to sacrifice almost every ounce of downtime in order to train. And here's the thing. Athletes are not surprised that their lives look different from everybody else's. Right? From friends and family who are not athletes, they know their life is going to look really different. And what about us? What are we willing to sacrifice to train in godliness? Time? Sleep? Security? Comfort? Control? Are we willing to lose these things to gain Christ? Now think about this for a moment. Jesus says, the eye is the lamp of the body. Now what does he mean by that? He means, be careful what you see. Because what you see, what you consume, can go into your heart and pollute it. So let me ask you this. Have you ever thought, I don't want to look at that. That's no good for me. Have you ever shut the computer? Have you ever turned something off and gone, nah, I don't want that. It's not good for me. I mean, athletes know what they're doing in this regard, don't they? They're pretty careful about what they put into their body. They've got specific diets and foods, right? They eat to help them just be tip-top shape, to compete at that top level. And what else do? They surround themselves with coaches and other inspirational people and other athletes who are even better than them to spur them on. I've just recently become a cyclist, many of you know, a mammal, a middle-aged man in Lycra, and I've just started doing it. I'm enjoying it. And they say, make sure you go riding with cyclists who are better than you, which is good for me because that's every single person out there right now. I'm terrible. But you go with people who are better than you because they spur you on. They make you want to be a better thing. They draw you in to their greatest skill. Right, there's some Mossman Hills around here. A good friend of mine rides ahead of me sometimes. He's like, whatever you do, just try and stay with me and focus on my back wheel. And I tell you what, I'm going 20 seconds faster up that hill because I'm with him. And what about us? How committed are we to be in tip-top shape as a Christian? It's worth thinking about, isn't it? How committed are we to carving out time in our day to hear from God? Through scripture reading, through prayer? How serious are we about how we spend our time with each other? We're talking about athletes spurring one another on. And how else are we going to get through? We need each other. Is this the priority? Is this, I'm missing this for anything? It's not in pencil, it's in pen. Whether it's online or here. Midweek, Sunday, whatever it is. How much do we prioritize using the gifts God's given us to serve other people? That's just how we grow. All of these things, that's how we grow. That's how we build our spiritual muscles. How we grow in godliness. We grow in the knowledge and love of God in this way. What's going to help us be in top shape as Christians? Let me say this. You show me a Christian who rarely opens the Word, hardly ever bends the knee in humble prayer, doesn't prioritize meeting with God's people, and I will show you a person struggling spiritually. okay. So like an athlete goes into strict training to achieve their goal, we train ourselves in godliness. Strict training. Let's move on to our next point here. Let's keep reading. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. We've seen that. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Now, the athletes that competed in the ancient games, their crown, what they got, was a wreath of wild flowers, a sort of a horseshoe shape. They sort of wear it on the head. That was what they competed for. That sounds kind of lame, though, doesn't it? I mean, thanks very much for the flowers. About 400 grand, that sounds pretty good for Ninja Warrior. But that's what they competed for. But it's not actually what they competed for, is it? That thing of wild flowers that fades away. No. They compete for the glory, of course. Right? For the ability to say, I'm the best. For the accolades of peers and fans. And to be able to stand there as number one. That's what people compete for. But even that fades pretty quickly. Professional surfer Joey Baran always dreamed of winning the Pipeline Masters. If you know anything about surfing, which I don't know much, but that is like the pinnacle, okay? It's a very prestigious surfing competition. And this was in his mind since he was a kid, since he was young, to win the Pipeline Masters. He dreamed about it so much, standing on that dais. Cheers, the girls, the champagne. That was just what he wanted. More than anything. Well, he became a very good surfer. And one year, everything aligned. He surfed so well, and this particular year, he won the Pipeline Masters. Dream come true. This was it. He got out of the water. It's just, this is what I've been dreaming about. He got to the podium. He stood where he dreamed of standing. He got the wreaths. He got the accolades. Champagne was flowing for a few moments. Then, as can happen in Hawaii and tropical places, this tropical storm just hit out of nowhere. Pelting rain fell down on everybody on the beach. Everybody scrambled and tried to find cover, except for Joey. Joey's like, I don't want to move. I'm staying here. Everybody else left, except for him. He was left there alone on the beach, holding the trophy. Looking strange, getting soaked, right? And he realized with devastating quickness just what he had worked so hard to achieve was not what he thought it would be. Unfortunately for him, he went in a massive downward spiral in his life. But praise be to God, God found him and turned his life around. He became a committed Christian. He's actually a pastor now. And he shares this story often when he's preaching the gospel of grace to people. You see, we are like the runner, boxer, guy who swims around the UK, whatever. I mean, that's crazy, isn't it? 10,000 calories, I'd do that without exercising. But anyway, we are like the runner. We are like the boxer. In that we are to be disciplined. And yet we're different. We're unlike them because our goal, our prize is utterly different. We run to get a crown that will last forever. What is that crown? What does Paul say? 2 Timothy, now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Paul's key theme in using the boxing metaphor is to remind us of the importance of keeping our focus on our eternal goal and disciplining ourselves to remain focused on this promised prize. Hear this. The goal is everything. The goal is everything. That crown of righteousness, elsewhere in the New Testament, it's talked about being a crown of life, the crown of glory. The goal is everything in the race. Now, I just want to pause here for a moment. I just think it's important to pause here because I get nervous talking about these things. There's a danger in preaching a sermon on discipline. There's a danger in preaching on Christian discipline. You see, it's pretty easy for me to kind of finish this message soon, and you're thinking, that'd be great, Dave. to finish this message soon and maybe get a story of a really disciplined Christian. That's easy to do. I've got so many of them. Find that and read that as an inspiration. Look how disciplined they were in their Christian. Look what they did. And then just end with, so go. Be like them. Go and be disciplined. Try harder. Come on. You can do it. Go. Do better to please God in your lives as more disciplined Christians. Let's pray. I could do that. That might make sense to a lot of us. You might be thinking, I kind of thought that's where you were heading with this, Dave. But it's not the gospel. You see, what happens if I do that is this. Two outcomes can happen to two different types of people. Different types of people. To the disciplined person, all I'm doing, if I say, go and be disciplined, all I'm doing is just feeding into your pride. Because you'll just think, great, job kind of done. I am disciplined in my life in lots of areas, and in my spiritual life, I'm pretty disciplined. Okay, cool. Compared to others, I'm doing great, and you'll hear in a moment, maybe compared to me, the preacher up there, I'm doing awesome. So I don't really need to do anything. I don't need to change much. Maybe a few little tweaks, a few little tips on how I can be more disciplined. That'd be helpful. But otherwise, you're not leaving here thankful for the grace of Christ. You're not thinking, I need the grace, love, and mercy of Jesus Christ. And then you're definitely not leaving grateful for it because you don't need it. See? That's one, to the disciplined person. That's a possible outcome. What about the other types of people in the room? If you're anything like me, you struggle with discipline. It's a very difficult area for you. And you've always thought, oh, this is so hard. And when you heard there was a sermon on discipline and Christian discipline, you thought, not again. Maybe already online you've muted me. I don't know. You've turned me down. You can't do that in the room. I'm so sorry. You can't do that here. But maybe that's what you checked out when you heard discipline, not again. This is hard for me. I struggle with every other area in my life in discipline. Now you're telling me being a Christian is all about just trying harder and doing better? What does that breed? It breeds despair, doesn't it? I can't do it. I can't do it. I'm a crap Christian. God's just disappointed with me again. You see what happens? All I've done is condemned you in your pride or condemned you in your despair. You don't need more tips on how to be disciplined. I'm not the person to give them to you. You don't need me making you feel guilty and full of despair for your lack of discipline. So what do we need? We need Jesus. We need, you and I need heart surgery. Only Jesus, the great physician, can do that deep and great work within us and give us the cure of the life that we need. I wonder if you've seen these new posters. They're fairly recent, I think. They just have "Be Kind" on them. Maybe it's because we're all going through a pandemic and it's all quite difficult, and maybe we, at the shops, we can get short with each other, and it's kind of understandable. And I don't know if it's from the government. I didn't look too closely, but it just said, "Be kind. Be kind to others." I just thought, oh, yes, that's kind of nice. I want to live in a community where people are more kind to each other. Okay, so hear that. More random acts of kindness, or I don't know, acts of kindness to that community, the better. Common grace, bring it on. I'm all for that. But just think about putting those words, "be kind," on a poster. It doesn't work. Why doesn't it work? It doesn't work because it's failing to diagnose the real problem. Why are people unkind? Not because they, just need to be reminded to be kind. People are unkind because we're selfish. We're self-absorbed, right? No poster's going to fix that because the problem's a spiritual problem caused because people are far away from the very definition of kindness. You can't legislate kindness. You can't legislate heart change. It doesn't work. We need a new heart. We need the great physician to do his work. We need Jesus utterly and completely to save us, to change us, to transform us, to reorder the love in our heart so we want to chase after him. You don't need to tell people to be kind who are full of the fullness of God. That's the fruit of the Spirit, isn't it? This is it. Hebrews 12. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer or author and perfecter of our faith. So instead of this question, if I ever ask this to you, feel free to slap me on the hand, socially distanced. I don't know how that's going to work. So instead of me asking you, how disciplined have you been in your Christian life this week? I'm never going to ask you that question. The question then changes to, what are you chasing after? What have you been chasing after this week? What are you desiring most? Where is your heart at? See the difference? Massive difference. Earth-shattering difference. Because no athlete trains for something they don't want. You hear that? Maybe an athlete can do it for a little while and go through serious sacrifice and training. But if the goal, if they don't really want it, they're not going to be training for long. We fight for what we want. So the job of the Christian preacher and the job of every Christian every day, every morning, is to fix our eyes on Jesus, to lift our eyes to him, to fill our vision with him, because he is the goal. I love Colossians 3:16. Let the message of Christ dwell in you richly. The word of Christ, the message of Christ, dwell in us richly. What is that? The gospel. And when our hearts are full of him and what he's done for us and who he is, oh, just try holding us back when it comes to praying, reading, serving, giving. Don't we want to chase after him when our hearts are full of him? You don't need, well, here's a strict discipline raise. You know, all those things help, absolutely. But that's not the goal. Let me try and give you an example. George Mueller, I think is how you pronounce it, was a Christian man who ran orphanages in the 1800s in Britain. Amazing. If you want to read just a crazy, awesome biography, read the biography of George Mueller. And he ran these orphanages on a smell of an oily rag. No money. Amazing man of prayer. Just crazy. Prayed for miracles and received them. Now, every day, he'd set aside time with God, and he would not leave that place, in his own words, until he was happy in the Lord. Isn't that interesting? He would not leave that place until he was happy in the Lord. Not until I finished my 4 chapters of the Old Testament, my 2 chapters of the four. That wasn't it. Until I do my set amount of prayer, and then I leave. No. I'm not leaving until I'm happy in the Lord. And what does he mean by that? Until the gospel is made new to him again. We need it each day. Until the grace of God was special in his heart again. Until his loves were reordered so that he loved Christ more than anything else. Until he knew happiness and joy in the Lord. Now, I'll just take this opportunity to be brutally honest. So much of my Christian life, I have felt guilty and condemned because of my lack of discipline. I'm not reading the Bible enough. I'm not praying enough. I'm not serving enough. I'm not giving enough. And let me tell you, thinking and dwelling upon those things stifles your spiritual life. It does nothing for wanting to foster the love of Christ in your heart. Let me say this. Those spiritual disciplines are essential, but they're not the goal. The goal is Christ himself. Nowhere near enough attention has been paid in my Christian life toward the posture of my heart towards God. Removing the idols I put in place, the things I love more than him, that take me away from him. Using the Bible and prayer and other people surgically well to remove those things. so I can love him more. This is the fuel for change. Remembering his priceless grace and asking him to apply it to me as he's renewing my mind and character. You see what we're talking about here? Let me ask you, what is holding you back from chasing after God, from filling your vision with him? No one trains for something they don't want. See, the only way we can strive, we can use our efforts in our Christian lives and go into strict training is if our hearts are fueled with the gospel. Only this eliminates despair and pride, because God humbles the proud and lifts up the humble. May our hearts be changed and drawn to Christ, the most extraordinary figure to ever live, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the absolute definition of love and mercy. Jesus Christ enters our story, becomes one of us, to live our life, to identify with his children, so that when you pray to him, you're not praying to some abstract God that has no idea what your life is like. He knows. He became a human. So he knows what it was like for us to live in our daily struggles. In his earthly ministry, it's no surprise that so many were drawn to him, full of compassion and mercy. His love for the outsider, for the outcast, for the nobodies. His incredible patience with his followers. Now, John preached a great message on patience last week. What about God's patience with us? Our failure to learn things again and again. How patient is he with us, his children? His incredible moral teaching that has never been surpassed, never been equaled. Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Wouldn't it be amazing to be close to him? To have him walk side by side with you? Wouldn't that be awesome? Look at what he did so you could be that close to him. Jesus Christ took off his heavenly crown. He deserved to wear it. King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Who knows how many heavenly beings were worshipping him in heaven? And he was Lord of them all. He had every right to wear a crown, to rule, to reign. He took it off. And he traded it in. For what? A crown of thorns. Why? So that you and I could wear a crown of righteousness. That we have no right wearing, but we get to wear because of his grace. That crown that will never perish, spoil or fade. Let me tell you, filled with this truth in our hearts, what could hold us back from wanting to train in godliness? With this as our goal, losing sleep, whatever. Sacrificing time, money, comfort, who cares? My eyes are fixed on Jesus. Brothers and sisters, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your gift of grace. Lord, we pray now that you do surgery on our hearts. Reveal to us the motives that we do things. Even the good things we do for approval. To put you in our debt. Lord God, we don't need tips. We need you and your presence in our hearts. So Father, right now, apply to us the saving work of Christ. As Christians, we need the gospel just as much as non-believers. Apply it to us. We want to live from that place, Lord God. May you be above everything else, the center of our lives. Take the seat in our hearts. love you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.